of the Lake Lorraine Community Fair. And basically, it's going to be a show and tell of what the artists and partners have brought to bear on this project that's started in the summer and is now, for now, has its season conclusion at this moment. So I thank everyone for coming out today. Thankfully, it's dry out there, so you don't have to put on your hip waders and come on down. What we're going to do is start off with my name is Andy Morey, by the way. And I'm one of the participants, the other artists will introduce themselves once we get going. But first off, I want to have a acknowledgement of territories. And to do that for us, it's through Barley.
Thanks everybody for coming. My traditional name is Wenkado Hanakut. From my father, I am Niska and Hada. From my mother, I am Lee Channel and Clayant. Niska territory is Aspen's Rupert. Clayant territory is up near Alaska. And Lee Channel territory is the west coast of Vancouver Island. I specifically come from the Friendly Cove area there. And I'm also out of Hawaii, which is, Queen Charlotte Islands. And you will notice that none of those nations are in this area. So I am a guest here. So I would like to take a moment to acknowledge the Musqueam, the Tsleil-Waututh, and the Squamish people. I want to thank them for allowing every single one of us out of those nations, including myself, to live, work, and play in a beautiful, unceded territory. When I say this land is unceded, I mean it has never been taken in conquest. It is occupied, but it has never been taken in conquest. It has never been sold, and it has never been given freely as a gift. And we need to remember that, and we need to acknowledge that. And my English name is Kurt Barley. I imagine that would be easier for everybody to say. Before we get started, I'm just going to take a moment to acknowledge why I decided to be a part of this project. I was the co-chair of the Downtown Inside Local Planning Process for far too long. Basically, doing that forced me to study how this city came to be. And this city is built on multiple waves of displacement. The first wave of displacement was the Coast Salish, the Musqueam, and the Tsleil-Waututh. Those people had resided in this land for 10,000 years. And about 130 years ago, they wanted to make way for a new city called Vancouver. So the area by Oppenheimer Park used to be a trading center, like a trading area. And the roots of American Sign Language are in this area, all up and down the coast. Because there's 27 different languages spoken here in British Columbia alone. And there's stories from my house, from my big house, of us feasting on oranges. And so that means those oranges had to commute from Florida all the way up to here. And we traded seal meat up near Alaska all the way down to the Californias. So the coast used to be like the ancient superhighways. And so you can imagine, in this area, there was many, many languages spoken. Many similar dialects, but many different languages. So Chinook, a trading jargon, was invented, and that's how people communicated. And there are also signs. So American Sign Language has its roots here. But they wanted to make room for the city, so it was outlawed for any more than three Aboriginals to be together at any moment, and it was arrestful. It was an arrestable offense to speak your language. It was an arrestable offense to witness a wedding, to witness a naming ceremony, to even say a prayer. And basically, that disrupted our bonds, like our family bonds, our bonds of brotherhood, nation to nation, sisterhood, nation to nation. And they cleared this area. Vancouver here about 100 years ago. And for the first few decades of this town, it was mostly a resource town. There was a lot lot of logging, mining going on in the areas. But basically can't work is like you work 3 weeks on and then you get 1 or 2 weeks off or something like that. And so these SROs in the neighborhoods, they were built for those camp workers. They were never built for permanent human habitation. And in this area used to be kind of like a unofficial red light district. And you know, there was body houses, there was speakeasies, there was beer parlors, you know, all that kind of stuff. And that kind of went against the normal community values. So this area, so like the sex workers were pushed out of the area and just working back streets and dark alleys and made it more dangerous for them to ply their trade. And that's happened several times since in the last 100 years. That's the first wave of displacement. The second wave of displacement started during World War II. Again, the Oppenheimer District area used to be Japan or Nihonmachi. Nihonmachi, yes. It used to be called Nihonmachi, and it was like a typical little Canadian town. Certainly there wasn't lanterns and people weren't, you know, walking around in kimonos with, you know, two swords on the sides, you know. They were covered walls, they sold Coca-Cola. Yes, the signage was Japanese, but it was basically a typical town. Typical little Canadian neighborhood. But then World War II started, sentiment against Japanese Canadians soured. So, they got pushed out of the neighborhood. All their buildings that they owned, the businesses that they owned, sold for minuscule prices. And many of them were shipped up to the PD grounds, which ironically at the time was called Happy Land. And then they were interned all over the province, all over the country. And which brings me to what? Hogan Valley? Hogan Valley. Not really part of the downtown east side. We're kind of being a little bit expansionist here, but we'll take it. The viaduct that goes between the stadiums, that wasn't there in the 60s. In the 60s, city council had this brilliant idea. They wanted to make a freeway system similar to that of LA here in Vancouver. And that little area was called Hogan Valley, and it used to be a predominantly black community. Black owned businesses, houses, it was a full-blown community. So out of all the neighborhoods that City Hall could have torn down to make way for this LA like freeway system, which only made it to one stage, I might add, they tore down the Hogan Valley. And ironically, now they want to tear down the viaduct and name it Hogan Valley as a messed up tribute to the past. And then that brings us to this current wave of displacement. This one is mostly income-based. It's driven by rapacious real estate speculation and investment. It's done to build nest eggs for the few at the cost of the many. And there's no reason for it other than selling a pretty view of the mountains, which everybody got in 2010. So this city is built on displacement and lies and corruption. And as I said at the beginning of this, it's unceded territory. So technically, the city is being illegal. So that's a short list of the ways of displacement. People have been consistently struggling in this area for the last 130 years at least. Consistently struggling for their right to remain in their ancestral homelands or in the community that they built. Sometimes at the most troublesome histories. We still made a community here. We're being forced out, and we don't want that. I went on a little bit more than I wanted to, but I always feel it's important to tell these stories of this place that I